A history of human-animal hybrids. The Centaur, Anubis, Mermaids, Ganesha. Human-animal hybrids have fascinated our kind for millennia, with these bizarre crossover species common to works of mythology, religion, and fiction sourced from all corners of the globe. Yet despite the efforts of a few intrepid perverts, so far the closest we've come to a true human crossbreed is Snoop Dogg, who scientists now believe to be 45% Dachshund. But recent research suggests we're inching towards a time where genuine hybrids may come into existence. So, who is doing this? How are they doing this? And why in the name of all that is holy are we even considering the creation of part human, part animal beings? Let's find out as we explore a history of human-animal hybrids. The first hybrids. You are a human hybrid. Yeah, that's right, you, sitting there at home in your pajamas, eating cereal from the packet. You are not 100% Homo sapiens, because depending on where in the world you're from, your genome may contain between 1.8 and 2.6% Neanderthal DNA. Human evolution is littered with examples of hybridization between our species and other homonyms, with some scientists even suggesting that such crossbreeding was crucial to our survival, since it imbued Homo sapiens with a diverse set of traits. And despite what your super racist uncle would have you believe, diversity is crucial to the success of any species. DNA evidence indicates that humans who were the product of Neanderthal-Homo sapien relations had a stronger immune response than pure Homo sapiens when they arrived in Europe. Geneticist Rasmus Nielsen of the University of California believes that interbreeding speeds up the acquisition of important mutations, which evolution may otherwise take a long time to generate. Archaeologist Rebecca Ackerman goes one further, suggesting that mixing with different homonym species even helped develop our complex human culture. The use of language, painting, and sexy dance moves gave Homo sapiens a distinct advantage over our rival homonyms. Ms. Ackerman, who works out of Cape Town University, believes that our ancient ancestors may have shared or gained the knowledge of these practices after they'd finished sharing sexy times with the Neanderthals. Can you imagine that? You've just played hide the sausage with a Neanderthal chick, and all she wants to do is talk to you about cave art. But such post-coital communication may have been important. Ms. Ackerman was quoted as saying that learning new habits and tricks from other species could have helped spur on our development. The things we think of as creativity could be the result of interaction between different groups. Some of her contemporaries disagree with this assessment, but either way, there seems no doubt that humans did indeed gain some crucial traits from their Neanderthal mates. In the future, it's hoped that the DNA of even earlier humans can be sequenced in order to find out more about our history of hybridization. It may be that we got fresh with many more of our homonym brothers and sisters than we ever thought possible. But it's one thing to mate with someone within your own genus and create a hybrid. It's entirely something else to try and combine two different species. Hybrid moments. Do you know the difference between a hybrid and a chimera? It seems the mainstream media doesn't, as many articles which have the word hybrid in their headline almost always go on to describe an experiment involving chimeras. We would never do such a thing, except for the fact that we just did right now. But let's make up for it by explaining the difference once and for all. Hybrids are created when the ovum of one species is fertilized by the sperm of another. You know, the old-fashioned way. The animal that pops out will then contain all the genetic information given to it by its parents. A chimera is created by a different process, in that it involves the introduction of cells, often stem cells, from one species into the embryo of another genetically distinct species. This leads to a creature that is composed of two types of cells, with one experiment from 2007 resulting in a sheep whose blood was 15% human, 85% sheep, and 100% delicious on toast. In August 2003, it was reported that researchers from Shanghai's Second Medical University had created the first chimeric embryos when they successfully fused human skin cells with rabbit ova. Thankfully, the embryos were only allowed to develop for a few days before being destroyed. Although maybe this wasn't a good thing after all. Because if we'd allowed human-rabbit chimeras to exist, perhaps we'd never have had to suffer through the abomination that is James Gordon's portrayal of Peter Rabbit. I can't claim to know precisely how Beatrix Potter would have liked Peter to be played, but I'm pretty sure she never envisioned him as a lad with proper good banter. For various biological and ethical reasons, it's not possible to directly breed two different species together through normal reproductive methods. And even where it is possible, the resulting offspring, such as ligers, mules, and jellyfish geese, are often rendered sterile. Instead, chimeras are seen as a less problematic alternative, and we've been using human cells to make such creatures since the late 1980s. The Chimera Era. In a 1988 study overseen by Dr. Irving Weissman of Stanford University, human bone marrow cells were transplanted into a strain of mouse which lacked its own immune system. The mouse, which was amusingly named a Hume mouse, did not reject the cells and thus developed an almost complete human immune system as a result. Another mouse-human combination was successfully attempted earlier this year when scientists managed to introduce human brain cells into the brain of a mouse. The lentil-sized human brain cell cluster was observed as being supplied with blood and nutrients from the original mouse brain. But, in a shocking turn of events, it was also seen to be attempting to communicate with the tissue. The mouse displayed no signs of increased intelligence or human behaviors, but we still have no idea whether this experiment altered the mouse's perception of itself and the world around it. The objective of this research was to see if human brain repair kits could become viable in the future, with small batches of brain cells potentially able to be injected into damaged brains to restore their original function. Other human-mouse chimeras have been used to successfully study the progress and treatment of viral conditions like HIV and hepatitis. However, while these experiments involved transferring cells to already grown animals, and thus did not result in the creation of a hybrid, the line between chimera and hybrid has been made less distinct by the recent creation of chimeric animal embryos. New York's Rockefeller University recently transplanted human cells into chicken embryos in an attempt to find out how a group of cells called organizer cells guide the development of an embryo. This research could be key to understanding and preventing miscarriages, but since it is illegal to culture human embryos beyond 14 days in the lab, the researchers got around this by creating a human-chicken mishmash, which I assure you is a highly technical term. A similar project undertaken by the Salk Institute in 2017 demonstrated how human cells could be introduced into a pig embryo and continue to grow as the fetus develops. This was actually believed to have been the first instance of successful human hybrid creation. And while such research is often used to help us understand more about the genetic markers for disease, on this occasion, the Salk Institute was investigating the use of humanized animals for potential organ donation. Animals with human livers, lungs, and hearts are now being seen as legitimate potential sources of replacement organs. Because apparently it's easier to get a pig to grow our spare parts than persuade humans to give them up after they're dead. Seriously, just offer people free Domino's and Netflix in exchange for their pancreas, and I guarantee we'll solve the shortage in 24 hours. In a further step towards chimeric animal donors, a February 2018 research project produced a sheep embryo which contained 0.01% of the human genetic code. Thanks to projects like this, the line between chimera and hybrid has now begun to blur. If one animal's cells are allowed to grow alongside another from the embryonic level, the resulting creature could be said to be a hybrid, not a chimera. So, how far down the line do we go with this? What percentage of human code should we limit ourselves to implanting within the embryos of animals? Are genuine human-animal hybrids on the horizon? Some researchers believe so, and we're going to investigate their concerns in our bonus video, The Unethical Future of Human Hybrids, which you can watch over at patreon.com/strangemysteries now. For a $2 monthly pledge, you'll gain access to this and over 100 more bonus videos, And you'll also become part of the Strange Mysteries community, where we interact with fans to discuss the topics we want to make and you want to see. Your contributions have a huge impact on our ability to produce mind-bending videos which explore fascinating topics in more depth than ever before. And nowhere is this more evident than in our premium videos, exclusive to our $20 Patreons, where we consult with the scientific community to investigate cutting-edge research before the mainstream media catches on. Here's a trailer for our latest premium video entitled
Chemicals of Reality. Reality, consciousness, brains. What else is there? Ask yourself that question. Perhaps that's all there really is, but perhaps everything else is found within a place where these ideas, these things, overlap. Some thing, some place that is undefinable. To many people, altering certain chemicals in their brains produces what they would simply call hallucinations. In fact, what we're going to discuss specifically used to be called the businessman's trip, as one could enjoy it. Come down and put your pants back on in the time it takes to eat lunch. It wasn't taken seriously. Well, unless, of course, you started digging. And some people, including us, did. Already, though, to many people, this chemical is special amongst others. Very special. To them, it represents something more meaningful and incredible, as if it's the gateway to the next level of consciousness. The ticket to a higher reality barely explored by most humans. It is the entry point to a new reality visited by only a select few whose minds have become enlightened through the use of this exotic substance. For this reason, it's commonly referred to as the spirit molecule. But is its reputation as a mystical mind opener deserved? Or is it and everything it represents just a load of bullshit? We look at, investigate, and dive deeply into nearly all available research regarding this question from nearly every angle feasible. And in the course of doing so, stumble upon unexplainable patterns, correlations, and neurological evidence for a reality existing beyond this one. Watch this hour-long Strange Mysteries premium video, Chemicals of Reality, as well as many more to come by becoming an elite premium member of our Patreon at patreon.com/strangemysteries.